Tonight's guest, as you all know, is Mr. Rick Riordan, the author of the best-selling series Percy Jackson and the Olympians. First of all, I'd like to thank the library and Mary and Stuart Cravens for making this night possible, as well as making possible the purchase of 600 copies of The Lightning Thief, which we were able to distribute to the schools. We also wanted to thank the school librarians and teachers who were so great and so enthusiastic about getting kids excited about this book. So we're thankful to them. But most of all, I'd like to thank Rick Riordan for being here with us tonight. His books are filled with humor, action, and heart. They get me in the heart. His demigod middle schoolers face challenges most of us, I hope, will never have to face ourselves, but they still feel like they could be your close friends. And I'm honored to have Rick Riordan here tonight to tell us a little bit more about himself and the books that he's written. Thank you.
Thank you guys very much. It's really good to be in Champaign. I'm glad that I could come and join you guys. A little bit about me. I was born in San Antonio. I grew up in Texas. I am a former middle school teacher. I taught 6th, 7th, and 8th grade for about 15 years. And I have two sons. One is 14 and one is 10. But I'm kind of curious about you guys, too. Do we have any readers here? I bet we do. Okay. I'm curious. Anybody want to tell me, like, what kind of book do you tend to pick up when you buy a book or go to the library and check out a book? What do you like to read? Yeah. Fantasy, okay, cool. On the aisle here in the blue shirt, yeah.
Anything from Harry Potter to yours.
Okay. Okay, cool. So a wide variety. Striped shirt in the very back. Scary books, all right. Any other ones right here?
From Harry Potter to the Kids' Garden.
Okay, well, that's a good variety there. Let me ask you a different question. Does anybody here like to write your own stories? Do we have any writers out there? Aha, ha, cool. Okay, I have a question for you guys then. What do you think it's easier to write about? Is it easier to write about stuff that actually happened to you, or is it easier just to make it up?
No.
How many would say make it up?
Make it up.
Okay, that's what I thought. That's what I thought. All right, here's why I ask. Because when I was your age, growing up in San Antonio, I knew that I wanted to be a writer, but I didn't really know what to write about. And I would always talk to my teachers, and I would say, okay, so I want to be a writer. What do I write? My teachers always said the same thing. They always said, Rick, write about what you know. And I hated that because the thing was, I didn't know anything. I didn't really know what to do. I mean, the stuff I knew was boring. I didn't want to write about that. So instead, I made stuff up. The first story that I remember doing, I was in eighth grade and I wrote this story about this guy who dies. That's the first thing that happens. He dies. And he goes to heaven and he has this conversation with an angel. And I showed it to my eighth grade teacher. And she said, wow, Rick, this is great. Let's get it published. And I was like, you can do that? I didn't know how you got something published. She said, well, let's try. She helped me to find a magazine, and she helped me to send off my story to see if I could get it published. I was so excited. I thought I was going to be rich and famous, and they were going to send me something really cool. And I waited. And I'm going to open this up here. I waited for probably about, a few months anyway. Let's see, slideshow. There we go. From beginning. Ooh, technology, fun. Finally, they sent me this in the mail. That's my first rejection note. Yeah, they told me no. And it's so old that if you look at it, you'll see it's not done on the computer because we didn't have computers. It was typed on a typewriter with all the mistakes X through. The guy was really nice. He said, Dear Richard, first of all, let's get it straight. There's no such thing as being too young to write. If you're old enough to tell a story, go for it. He said, this is really good for somebody who's 13, but we can't use it. Keep trying. My mom was so proud that I got rejected. She put this in a frame, and she hung it in the house, and I had to look at it every time I walked through the living room. Yeah. True story, too. When I was in college, my mom's house burned down in this big fire. Everything was destroyed. Except that. They pulled the letter out of the fire, totally fine, not a mark on it. She put it back in a frame and it's still hanging in my mom's house. It's like it's cursed or something, it's terrible. But I kept trying, kept writing like the guy said. I went to college, I got married, I became a teacher. My wife and I decided to move out to California for a while. So we lived out in the San Francisco area. It's really nice. But I got homesick for Texas, and I started thinking, well, maybe my teachers were right. Maybe I should try to write something about what I know. So I started a murder mystery set in San Antonio. Now, have you guys ever read a mystery where there's like a crime you have to solve? Okay. You seen shows like that on television before? CSI? Yeah, my favorite Scooby-Doo, but okay. Anyway, I started writing a mystery, and I used to tell my students that you're supposed to make an outline. So I did, and here's my outline. The real thing is about, well, yeah, that is about the real size, I guess. It's huge. And every square is a chapter in the book. And you can see I've written notes to myself. I cross stuff out. I move stuff around. So this kept me from getting writer's block. I would just look at the wall and I'd say, okay, today I'll write that square. I went through the whole thing. It took me a year to write the entire book. When I was done, that's what I had. That's the manuscript for my first book, which was called Big Red Tequila. Anybody want to guess how many pages? Right here in the stripes. Yeah. 325, right here. 750, what do you think? 450. It's close, about 375 pages. And inside every page, covered in correction marks. Did they ever make you guys do that in school? When you...
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Do you find that annoying when you have to do that?
Yes.
Yeah, me too. But you know, I found out that you can't write something perfect the first time. It can't be done. I had to rewrite this entire book 14 times before I finally got it right. Yeah, was it fun? No. But finally it got published, and there was the cover. Big Red Tequila. Everything in Texas is bigger, even murder. Well, it did well. It won some awards, and the editor said, why don't we make it a series? So I started writing one a year. There's a second one, The Widower's Two-Step. Here's the fourth one, The Devil Went Down to Austin. Some of these even came out in other countries. There's the second one, The Widower's Two-Step. Can you tell what language it's in, though? What does it look like to you? Yes, right here.
Chinese.
Chinese, you're close. Over here. Japanese, right. Have you ever seen a Japanese book?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the other way, right. It's the front cover's on the back, and they go backwards like that. Not only that, but if you look inside, in Japan, you don't read right to left, you read up to down. I said that in California at a school one time, and this girl said, oh, so that's why. I said, what? She said, I was on the plane with someone, and they were reading in Japanese, and they kept going. Finally made sense. But these were all for adults, these books. And I was teaching school. Here's a picture of me in my classroom when I taught eighth grade. And one day, one of my students said, Mr. Riordan, can I do a book report on one of your books? I want to read Big Red Tequila. And I said, no, you can't read that. That's not appropriate. There's bad language and there's violence. All the kids said, really? And then they all went out and started reading the books. I got really embarrassed. And they said, well, write something for us. I mean, your teacher, come on. I didn't know what to write about. And then my son, when he was about 9, he started getting interested in Greek mythology. I would tell him stories at home about Hercules and Perseus cutting off the head of Medusa and Zeus and Artemis and all the gods of Olympus. And then I ran out and he got mad. He said, Dad, tell me a Greek myth tonight. I said, that's it. I've told you every single one. He said, well, make one up. I was like, yeah. How do you make up a Greek myth? Okay, all right, how about this? What if the Greek gods were still around? After all, they're supposed to be immortal. They can't die, so they must be somewhere. What if they were still falling in love with humans and they had kids that were half god, half mortal, like Hercules was, demigods, half-bloods? What would it be like if you found out that your real mom or your real dad was a Greek god? And I'm curious, who would you want to have as a mom or a dad? Any favorites out there? Gray in the Isle, yes, sir. Uh-huh. Poseidon, god of the sea. You'd have water powers, you could breathe underwater and make toilets explode. That'd be awesome. Yeah, yeah. In the very back, second from the aisle, yeah. Ares, god of war, is your father. That would be great until he got mad at you. Not so good. Right there, yes, party pony. Zeus, yeah, Lord of the Sky with this lightning bolts. That could really come in handy. Hey, Dad, this guy's annoying me. Boom! Yeah, let's get one more right here. Athena, goddess of wisdom. Yeah, that'd be awesome. You'd never have to study for another test, ever. That'd be great. Well, yeah, put your hands down. I have to tell you my favorite answer. I was at a school in San Antonio, my hometown, and I said, all right, guys, what Greek god would you want as a mom or a dad? This girl raises her hand really excited. Ooh, Batman! Okay. Well, anyway, I made up this kid, right? Percy Jackson. I just created him off the top of my head. He was 12 years old when the story began. He lives in New York City. He's never known his father. He thinks his dad is dead. He finds out his father's not dead. His father's a Greek god, which is bad news because if you're a demigod, by the time you hit middle school, all the monsters want to kill you, and you have to learn to defend yourself. So Percy goes on this quest to find a missing lightning bolt, and he meets a girl named Annabeth because he needs help. And Annabeth and Percy, at first, they don't get along because, well, Athena and Poseidon don't get along. They have this old feud. And so nobody really knows what's going to happen, if they're going to get along or end up strangling each other. But they end up helping each other. They find out their teacher is actually a centaur. He's a horse from the waist down. Later on, Percy finds out he's got a half-brother who's a cyclops. And his best friend, Grover, is really a satyr. He's a goat from the waist down. And they have all these adventures. I just made it up. When I was done, my son said, Dad, you ought to write that down. And I said, nah, I don't have time. He said, no, really, Dad, write it down. So, like, fine. I wrote it down. I read it to some of my students. And they told me to send it off. So I gave it to an agent in New York, a lady named Nancy Galt. She said, oh, this is great. Let me represent you. So she became my agent. She sent it off to the publishers. And right away, 5 different publishers wanted to publish it. So it went into an auction. They were all bidding on it to see who the high bidder was going to be. The winner of the auction was Disney Books. There's my editor now, Jennifer Besser. And Jennifer said, oh, this is great. I have a great idea for the cover. We're going to make the lightning thief look like this. I said, wow, that's boring. I said, can't you do something more exciting? So they hired an artist who does the covers for video games. And he said, okay, let's have a bunch of monsters jumping off the cover. And so, when the Lightning Thief first came out, that's the cover that it had. Now, I saw some of you guys actually have that cover. They don't make it anymore. It's a little hard to find. But there you've got Medusa and the Minotaur, and everybody looks at the dog and says, hey, it's Fluffy from Harry Potter. But, of course, you guys probably know that's really Cerberus, Guardian of the Underworld. Some people love this cover. Some people hated this cover. So they changed it when the paperback came out, and now the Lightning Thief looks like this. With Percy with his sword, etc. Yeah, it's the one you're probably familiar with. Well, then a funny thing happened. It started coming out all over the world. Here is me in England with my British editor, Sarah, and that's me at a British school. In fact, I just got back from England a couple of days ago. I was over there doing school visits for a week. Their first idea for a British cover was that, but nobody could tell what the thing was at the bottom. It's supposed to be the lightning bolt. They decided to change it so it has something everyone could recognize, a flying shoe. And there's a pair of flying shoes in the book, so, you know, that kind of made sense. But again, some people loved it and some people hated it, and we had a big debate which one was better, the British or the American one. I don't know, what do you guys like better? See, I'm hearing both. You know, it was so frustrating when they first came out. I went all over the United States. Everybody said the same thing. Everybody said, oh, the British cover's so much cooler. Why can't we have that one? And I was getting all depressed. I thought, we got the wrong cover. And then I went to England, and I talked to all the kids over there, just like I'm doing with you guys. And I figured, yeah, you know, all the British kids are going to like their cover, too. As soon as the British kids saw the American cover, they were all like, oh no, the American cover's much better. Can't win. And now, they've actually changed the British cover, so now in England it looks like that. Yeah. And now everybody over here wants that one, I know. Well, Since then, it's come out in about 22 foreign languages and counting. Here's The Lightning Thief in French, Le Voilu de Faudre. The Lightning Thief in Spanish, El Ladrón de Rayo. The Lightning Thief in Chinese, I'm not even gonna try that one. The Lightning Thief in Swedish. The Lightning Thief in Japanese. Anime, Percy, yeah, I like that one. The Japanese translator, however, had a tough time with this. She was hired to turn it into Japanese, and she did know English, but she didn't know a lot of American words, so she kept emailing me from Tokyo, asking me questions. What does this mean? What does that mean? One day she wrote me from Tokyo, she said, Mr. Riordan, please, what is a wedgie? Never mind. Here's The Lightning Thief in Korean. It's not bad. However, I must say, my favorite one is the German cover. Everyone warned me about the Germans. Everyone said, yes, the Germans are very serious people. And they like dark, somber covers with very serious images. And so, I was preparing myself for this serious German cover. And then I get it, and it has the Minotaur in his underwear. Very serious, yes. Well, anyway, that was The Lightning Thief. There will be 5 books in the Percy Jackson series by the time his story is all told. The second one, The Sea of Monsters, their first idea for a cover looked like that in the US. Yeah. Ah, but you've never seen that before because they never ended up making that. They decided to change it at the last minute and make a cover that matched the green Lightning Thief cover. That's why today in the US it looks like this. With Percy and Annabeth, they're running across the bridge of death with this giant cyclops eye in the background. And usually people say, oh, that's an eye? I thought that was a frisbee. But supposed to be an eye. The first British cover looked like this. Not bad. And now they've changed it so it looks like that. But, you know, I still think that probably the Germans came through with the most interesting cover. By the way, the Germans have a great Percy Jackson website. I went to their website. I don't speak German, but I was looking around. It was very interesting. They had like listings for all the characters. I don't know if you've read The Lightning Thief, there's the character named Smelly Gabe. He's like the evil stepfather. Yeah. You know how you say Smelly Gabe in German? Gabe der Stinker. I like it. Probably the hardest cover to get right, though, was the third one, The Titan's Curse. Man, that was tough to get the cover right. John Rocco is the artist. He does all our covers. And he did all these sketches for us. He did these. We liked that one, but we said, with the Nemean lion, everybody thought that looked too much like The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And so they did this one with Thalia and the other demigods out in the woods. Yeah. And then he did this sketch. And we said, that's pretty good, John. Can you make that one? So that's what we used for The Titan's Curse. It has Percy on his Pegasus. He's about to leap off. Yeah, exactly. He's about to leap off the Chrysler building. But these vines are wrapping around the horse so he can't get away. I love this cover. The first time I showed it, I was at a middle school in Austin. I was all proud. I was like, ha-ha, The Titan's Curse. This kid in the audience goes, look, he's riding a hippo. And then I was in Dallas at this other school, and this kid tried to make me feel better, and he said, no, Mr. Riordan, it's not a hippo, that's a moose. So now, every time I look at this, I'm like, yeah, there's Percy riding his war moose into battle. That's great.
Well, the British cover is almost as good. It has the skeleton with the ketchup bottle bouncing off his head. And now they've changed it so it has this cover instead. Not bad. Now, the last Percy Jackson book to come out so far, number 4, The Battle of the Labyrinth, that was John's first sketch for the cover. And I said, John, that's great, but can you make him look a little bit older? Because he's supposed to be 14 in this book. And so we did, and that was the cover we used. It has Percy with his sword, and he's looking into a golden coffin, and the lid is open. Light is streaming out of it. The British cover I also like. That's the British cover. Oh, yeah. But I gotta tell you guys, I'm real excited because the 5th Percy Jackson book, The Last Olympian, comes out May 5th. I'm really excited about this one. We just announced the cover a couple of weeks ago. Here is the American cover for The Last Olympian. Yeah, I'm excited. Yeah. I wanted to call the book Revenge of the War Moose, but they wouldn't let me. And here's the UK cover for The Last Olympian. And now, the book is top secret until it comes out in May. But I thought, if you guys don't mind, I would read you a little sneak peek. The Last Olympian. Okay. Now, just to set this up, this is a very short little excerpt. Just to set this up for you, Percy has a mission. This is from the very first chapter. He and one of the other demigods, Beckendorf, they're riding on Blackjack, the Pegasus, and they're off to find the Princess Andromeda, which is Luke slash Kronos' headquarters. It's a cruise ship. If you guys have read the series, you know what I'm talking about. All right, here's what happens when they go on a commando mission together. It was almost dark by the time we spotted our target. The Princess Andromeda glowed on the horizon, a huge cruise ship lit up yellow and white. From a distance, you'd think it was a party ship, not the headquarters for the Titan Lord. Then, as you got closer, you might notice the giant masthead, a dark maiden in Greek chiton, with wrapped in chains around her with a look of horror on her face, as if she could smell the stench of all the monsters she was being forced to carry. Seeing the ship again twisted my gut into knots. I'd almost died twice on the Princess Andromeda. Now, it was heading straight for New York. Blackjack, I said, set us down on the lowest stern deck.
Gotcha, boss, he said. Man, I hate seeing that boat.
He folded his wings and plummeted toward the boat like a black comet. I saw monsters patrolling the upper decks, Drakeni, snake women, hellhounds, giants, and humanoid seal demons known as Telkines. But we zipped by so fast, none of them even raised an alarm. We shot down the stern of the deck, and Blackjack spread his wings, lightly coming to a landing on the lowest deck.
Good luck, boss, Blackjack said. Don't let him turn you into horse meat.
With that, my old friend flew off into the night. I took out my pen out of my pocket and uncapped it. Riptide sprang to full life, 3 feet of deadly celestial bronze. Beckendorf pulled a piece of paper out of his pocket. I thought it was a map, and then I realized it was a photograph. He stared at it in the dim light, the smiling face of Selena Beauregard, daughter of Aphrodite. They'd started going out last summer, after years of the rest of us saying, duh, you guys like each other. We'll make it back to camp, I promised. For a second, I saw worry in his eyes, and then he put on a confident smile.
You bet, he said. Let's go blow Kronos back into a million pieces.
We followed a narrow corridor to a service stairwell, just like we'd practiced, but then we froze when we heard noises from above us.
I don't care what your nose says,
snarled a half-human, half-dog voice, a Telkine.
The last time you smelled half-blood, it turned out to be a meatloaf sandwich. Meatloaf sandwiches are good,
the second voice said.
But this is half-blood, I swear. They're on board. Blah, your brain isn't on board.
They continued to argue, and we descended as quietly as we could. Finally, we came to a metal hatch. Beckendorf mouthed the words, engine room.
It was locked, but Beckendorf pulled out some chain cutters and split the bolt. Inside, a row of yellow turbines, as big as grain silos, churned and hummed. Pressure gauges and computer terminals lined the wall. Talkines was hunched over a console, but he was so involved with his work, he didn't notice us. He was about 5 feet tall, with slick black seal fur and stubby little feet. He had the head of a Doberman, but clawed hands that were almost human. He growled and muttered as he tapped on his keyboard. Maybe he was messaging his friends on uglyface.com. I stepped forward and he tensed, probably smelling something was wrong. He leaped sideways toward a big alarm button, but I blocked his path. He hissed and lunged at me, but one slice of riptide and he exploded into dust. One down, Beckendorf said, about 5,000 to go. He tossed me a jar of thick green liquid, Greek fire, one of the most dangerous magical substances in the world. And then he threw me another essential tool of demigod heroes, duct tape. Slap that one on the console, he said. I'll get the turbines. We went to work. The room was hot and humid, and in no time, I was drenched in sweat. I had just attached a second jar of Greek fire to the console when I heard the pounding of feet on metal steps. So many creatures coming down the stairwell, I could hear them over the engines. Not a good sign. I locked eyes with Beckendorf. How much longer? Too long. I still have to wire the receiver, prime the charges. 10 more minutes at least. Judging from the sound of the footsteps, we had about 10 seconds. I'll distract them, I said. I'll meet you at the rendezvous point. Percy, wish me luck. He looked like he wanted to argue. The whole idea had been to get in and get out without getting spotted. But we were going to have to improvise. Good luck, he said. And I charged out the door. And that's a little look at the last Olympian. Now, people usually ask me two questions. They usually say, are you ever going to do a book that's not a Percy Jackson book? Well, the answer is yes. I don't know if you're familiar with this series. It just started in September. And this is very different, but it's a lot of fun. 39 Clues. It's 10 books. I designed the whole story arc for the entire series, and I wrote the first book. And then the other books, every one is written by a different author, but they're all about the same story, Amy and Dan Cahill. And basically, Amy and Dan, brother and sister, they know they have a big family. They don't realize how big until their grandmother dies, and then hundreds of people come from all around the world to the funeral. And the will is read, and the will says, all of you are members of the Cahill family, whether you knew it or not, and you have a choice for your inheritance. Either you can take $1 million right now and walk out the door, or you can take the first of 39 clues. The first team among you that finds all 39 that are spread around the world in the most dangerous places and puts them together successfully will find a secret that will make you the richest, most powerful people in the world. $1 million or one clue? You have 5 minutes to decide. I don't know what you guys would do, but Amy and Dan say, okay, we're in. Give us the first clue. And pretty soon they're fighting 6 other teams on a round-the-world hunt for the 39 clues. So I wrote the first one. It started in September. The other question people ask is, are you making a movie? Yes. Several of you asked me that tonight, and in fact, the answer is yes. They are working on the Lightning Thief movie right now. 20th Century Fox is the movie studio. Why is Harry Potter there? Because the guy in the middle is Chris Columbus. He directed the first 2 Harry Potter films. He will be directing the Lightning Thief movie. Now, what can I tell you? They have finished the script. In fact, when I get back to Texas, the script will be waiting for me to read. It'll be my first time to see it. So as of Wednesday, I should know something about, right now I don't know, but I should know something on Wednesday. I know they start filming next month. And it should be out in 2010. And just last week, secret information finally broke. I couldn't say anything, but I can now announce who will be playing Percy Jackson in the movie. And I can tell you who's playing Grover, too. I don't know the rest. Percy Jackson will be played by a young actor named Logan Lerman. That's him. He is best known because he was Christian Bale's son in the movie 310 to Yuma, the Western. He's a little bit older now, but I think he looks a lot like Percy Jackson. It'll be interesting.
Now, Grover was a much more interesting pick. I didn't see this one coming, but the more I thought about it, I think it's a pretty interesting pick. Grover is going to be played by a guy named Brandon T. Jackson, and he was the youngest soldier in the movie Tropic Thunder. It's a comedy. He's very funny. And so he's a very different guy than I pictured Grover, but I think he could really be a good Grover because he's really a funny guy. So we'll see what happens. No word on who's playing Annabeth yet. I know that they probably have somebody, but I don't know who it is yet. Anyway, so that'll be the Lightning Thief movie out next year. And they're also making a 39 Clues movie.
Awesome.
Steven Spielberg is working on that one for DreamWorks. So we'll see what happens with that. Okay, and now, in a moment, we'll be playing a little trivia quiz. And we'll see what you know. But before we do that, I saw some hands out there. We do have time for a few questions if you guys had things that I didn't cover and you're curious about. Over here, yes, sir. Oh, I just kind of made it up as I was telling it to my son. I made all those old stories happen today. So, yeah, it was really that simple. Yes?
The last book,
it's almost exactly the same as The Lightning Thief. Okay, so it's the longest book since The Lightning Thief, if that makes sense. Right here. Will all five be made into movies? Right now, the plan is to make them all into movies, but that depends on how well they do with the first one. If it's good and people like it, then yes. If, you know, if they mess it up, then probably no. So we'll just have to hope that they do a good job. Yes?
Would Cronus be Percy's grandfather?
Yeah, it makes your brain hurt to think about it too much, but yeah, Cronus would be Percy's granddad, but that's just too weird to even think about, yeah. Yes, in the yellow on the side. Yeah, go ahead. Any more books about Greek mythology? Well, here's the deal. Percy's story will kind of wrap up in The Last Olympian, and you'll find out everything you want to know, like does he get together with Annabeth or not? Does he live or die? Is he the guy that has to make the final decision about the prophecy? What happened? All of those will be answered. But after book five, what's going to happen is, in about a year from then, I'm going to be publishing a separate new series of Camp Half-Blood books. It's like the next generation of demigods. Now, you may see some of your old friends from the first series in that book, but if so, they'll sort of be older. They'll be like counselors rather than like the main characters. But when you finish The Last Olympian, you'll have a pretty good idea what I'm talking about because I kind of set it up for the next series, and you'll see what I mean. In the back in the red, go for it. Do I know what month? I've heard two different things. I think the most recent word is that February 2010, so not quite a year from now. That's the last I heard. But, you know, that could change. Just keep checking the website. My website is rickriordan.com. All the information I have will be posted there. Yes, on the aisle.
I think it was 2 million.
Yeah, you know why that you're remembering that is because every person gets a million. So Amy and Dan together, yeah, they did end up burning 2 million. You're absolutely right. So it's like two. It's like a million per person. Yes. What god would my mother or father be? You know, I'd like it to be Poseidon. With my luck, I'd get like Dionysus or somebody. I don't know. Okay, yes, right here.
Which is your favorite book in the series?
Favorite book? Gosh, I don't know. It's usually the last one I wrote, so I'd have to say The Last Olympian. If not that, probably The Battle of the Labyrinth. Let's get a couple more. Yeah. Yes, as soon as I find out, well, as soon as I can say, they'll tell me before I can tell anybody. As soon as I'm allowed to say, I will definitely post them on my website. That's the best place to go. Okay, let's get one more yes, ma'am, in the gray in the back. If I was a god, which one would I be? I'd actually kind of like to be Chiron the Centaur, the immortal teacher. I think that'd be really cool. Although I'm not sure I would want to be a horse from the waist down. I don't know. All right, well, if you didn't get to ask questions, don't worry. You'll get to ask questions afterwards if you want. But right now, let's do the quiz and see what you know. Now, if you know the answer, don't shout it out. Raise your hand. I'll do my best to get to as many of you as I can, but there's only 8 questions, so obviously I can't get to everybody. But we'll do our best. Ready? Who was the ruler of the gods in Greek mythology? On the aisle in the blue toward the back, I think I saw you first. Yes, uh-huh. The answer is Zeus. Well done. That's a good one. All right, I have a feeling we're not going to be stumping too many people tonight. But that's good. Let's see what we got next. Perseus killed the monster Medusa. What would happen to Medusa's victims? What would she do to her victims? We're going to go over here. Yes. She would turn them to stone. Nicely done. Question 3. When Perseus cut off Medusa's head, a beautiful winged horse appeared from her body. What was the name of the horse on the aisle in the very back? Yes, ma'am. Pegasus is correct. Well done. Question 4. Who was the Greek god of the sea? The Greek god of the sea. We're going right over here. Yes. Yep. Poseidon is correct. Nicely done. Okay, question 5. The name of the watchdog of the underworld, and no, Fluffy is not correct. Going back over here. Yes, sir, right here. Cerberus is correct. Nicely done. Okay. Got a tough one now. Well, I think it's tough. Athena had a constant companion who was the spirit of victory. I'm looking for the name of the goddess of victory. A hint for you, we named a sports shoe company after her. Going over here in the stripes right here. Nike is correct. Well done. My favorite answer, I was at a school one time, I said, okay, it's a sports shoe company. This kid said, oh, Foot Locker. Oh, great goddess Foot Locker. Question 7. Who is the god of the underworld and the lord of the dead? Very back in the stripes in the middle, yes. Say again? Hades is correct. Nicely done. And last question. What is the name of the river that you would cross to get into the underworld, the river of the underworld, sir? Yeah. River Styx. Well done. All right. Would my 8 contestants please come to the front, please? Come on down if you were one of the 8 that just answered a question. 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8. All right. You guys, we have something special for you. As you know, when the kids go off to summer camp at Camp Half-Blood, they wear these orange camp t-shirts to show your demigods. You're going to be our demigods today. You're going to get your very own Camp Half-Blood t-shirts. They say Camp Half-Blood on one side, and on the other, demigod in training. Well done. There you are. Good job. There you go. There you go, guys. Nicely done. All right, they did a great job. You guys are all awesome. I'm sorry I don't have t-shirts for all of you. Some people, I was going through the line, and some people have made their own. You should look at the ones that people made of their own. They're actually, you know, at least as good as mine, so they're awesome. So congratulations, all you guys. Huh? No, they're all good. Anyway, thank you guys for joining us tonight. It was great talking with you. And if you didn't get to have a book signed and you have more questions or whatever, come back on through the line, and I would love to see you again. Thank you guys very much.